Welcome back everyone to this lesson about the finite element analysis of beams. In the previous video, we discussed how we apply the boundary conditions of a beam to the system equation, a system of equations. For now, we are going to take all the information we have used, we have covered before, and try to see how a program written in Octave, which is the same script like Matlab and Freemat. If you are interested in any of the three, they actually use the same script, the .m file with the same basic language in them. Anyway, so let's go to the Octave and see how the program works. The program link is available below the video in the on the Academy of Knowledge website. You can download it from there. It's published already on GitHub. So here we are, the Octave. This is the program. I always start my programs by clearing the memory and clearing the console. Start with the program data, the number of elements, the number of nodes, sorry here, this is the number of nodes, and the number of degrees of freedom, which is twice the number of the nodes, which is equal to the number of elements plus one. Then we get the geometry. It has, I'll use a beam of length 2. Just for the sake of having finally the length equal to one of each of the elements. And since we are using two elements, of course, we will be able to change this number anytime. Then it has a width of 2 centimeters and a thickness of 1 centimeter, which is quite a thick beam. Then I use the material properties of aluminum, the modulus of elasticity, 71 gigapascal, the density 2700 kilogram per meter cubed, and the thermal expansion coefficient. Notice that the density and the thermal expansion coefficients will not be of any use to us in this program, but you know, it's just there. If I modify the program, I can use them at will. Anyway, the following step is calculating the area and calculating the second moment of area. These are geometric properties of the cross section. The area is useful if I'm using a bar. The second moment of area is useful if I'm using a beam. And for the sake of this program, the beam, the second moment of area is what I really need. Then I calculate the length of the element. The length of the element is the total length of the beam divided by the number of elements. And finally, here I am. The stiffness matrix will be of the element. Again, I'm having two identical elements, so I need to calculate the stiffness matrix only once. It's equal to the modulus of elasticity times the second moment of area divided by L cubed. I prefer to write it this way, putting the divisions at the end, but it doesn't really matter. And if you're suspicious, just use brackets to make sure that what you are writing or the order of the multiplication is done properly. Anyway, here the matrix, you can compare these terms with the terms we have in the notes or in the previous videos. This is the stiffness matrix of a beam. Now comes the assembly. The first step of assembly is initializing the empty matrix. So it will have its all zeros with the size of the number of degrees of freedom. So for the case of the example we presented last video, in the previous video, this is 6 by 6. Now going to the assembling. The assembly is just a loop that runs over all the elements. So for each element, I'm going to take its degrees of freedom and use them to place the element matrix inside the stiffness matrix, the global stiffness matrix. So, for example, let's see here. If I equals 1, the first element, y equals 1, this is going to be 1, and this is going to be 4. The first element extends from the first row to the fourth row, and here the columns, the same thing here, you have it extends from 1, remember I equals 1, to 4. Okay, so this is the global matrix that I'm going to put in, or the part of the global matrix which is going to contain the result. What result? The result of adding what's already there. Compare, this is identical to this. Okay, so I'm taking what's already there. Of course, for the first element, there is nothing but zeros, but I'm making sure that for every other element, I'm going to do the same procedure. So here you are. This is a 4x4 submatrix of the global matrix. Then I add to it the element matrix and put everything back into where it belongs in the global matrix. If I go to the second element, just for the sake of illustration, I will be equal to 2. So this is 4 minus 1, 3. It will start from 3 and end up at what? Here, you see, 2 plus 1, 3 times 2 equals 6. So it will extend from 3 to 6. And this is also 3 to 6, where the second element should be placed. And this time, this will not be equal to a zero submatrix. This will contain something from the first element and add to it the stiffness matrix. Anyway, now I'm ready with the global matrix. I need to identify and use the boundary conditions. My boundary conditions are that the degrees of freedom number 1 and 2 are constrained, and constrained at the value of 0. So what do? I take these two, I create a vector called BCs and put 1 and 2 in it. That's just like that. It's a very simple procedure. Having this, I create the auxiliary set of matrices. I take the submatrix, the 1 and 2, if you can see here, the 1 and 2 of the global matrix, the first two rows, put them in the auxiliary matrix, okay, and remove the first and second columns, okay? So now auxiliary matrix is what size? It's 2x4. Maybe if I run this quickly here, I can show you this right away. K auxiliary, there it is. It's a 2x4 matrix, okay? Those two rows are coming from the two rows of the global matrix. Now I apply the boundary conditions of the that I have on the global matrix by removing the first two rows and the first two columns from the global matrix. Okay, so now I have what, a 4x4 global matrix. Let's say K global. There you are. It's a 4x4 matrix containing the remaining elements of the global matrix. Notice the zeros here. These are exactly the numbers that we got from in the example, the symbolic example. But here, when we use the numbers again, we got zeros at the same location. Anyway, now I'm going to create a force vector. It has a length of the number of degrees of freedom and one column. Then I'm going to remove the boundary condition columns. This is an extra step. I could have used it here right away, but anyway, F global. Now I'm going to add a force at the end. Remember, this is a cantilever beam, so I'm going to use the before last degree of freedom and put a force, a vertical force, at that point. This is the only force I'll be having in this problem. Now the force vector is ready. the global stiffness matrix after removing the columns and the rows is ready. So all what I need to do is get the displacements as inverse of K global times F global. Actually, these are the numbers here. If we rerun it, here you are. So the first, remember, the first will be the first deflection, the deflection of the second node, then its slope, the deflection of the last node and its slope. And for the reactions, I multiply the auxiliary equations by the displacements, and I get here the minus 1 and the minus 2, because the reaction forces will be acting in the opposite direction of the applied forces. So if maybe we can go here and change the number of elements to be equal to, say, 5, run. And again, you get the same number, the same deflection at the tip, the same reactions, but you get more information inside the beam. Of course, you can increase the number here as far as you want. Let's just play a very small trick here by changing the second moment of area to 1. Okay. And the modulus of elasticity also to 1. Of course, this is nonsense. It doesn't exist physically, but I want to visualize the element matrix. Remember now, the element, the length of the element is going to be 1 because I'm going to use two elements again here. So the length of the element is 1, modulus of elasticity of 1, and its I, second moment of area, is 1. So I end up with only the matrix here. Let's just visualize it here. Here you are, KE. Here, 12, 6, 6, 4. And these are exactly the numbers that we should have expected from the derivation we did before. Again, let's have a look at the global matrix. I'm just illustrating here how exact the numbers are, just for the sake of illustration, nothing more. But if you made any mistake writing the code, maybe you will get different numbers indicating that something is wrong. So this is one of the tricks that I use to see whether I'm working right or wrong. It's just to put these constants by 1 to make sure that it's working. Anyway, now back to the original program. This code, as simple as it is published now on GitHub. The link is available below the video in on the Academy of Knowledge website. You can download it from there. And I hope that it was really clear for you. And thank you very much.